one of the many, well, impromptu services we've seen around the country really over the last couple of days. The Prime Minister today, of course, signalled that we will be having a national memorial at some point, not this week, but next week most likely. Now, she also signalled that changes in New Zealand's gun laws are really just days away, with a decision made in principle by Cabinet today to push on with some, well, prompt reforms. Dr John Coyne is the director of the Australian Strategic Policy Institute's Border Security Program. He's an expert in terrorism. This afternoon I asked him about Australia's tougher gun laws and whether he believed the Christchurch attack could have been avoided.
Look, there's always a number of factors that contribute to successful terrorist attacks. In this case, I think that had the New Zealand government adopted the gun laws that had been used in Australia since the dreadful Tasmanian attack at Port Arthur that were introduced by the Australian Prime Minister at the time, John Howard, I think that this attack would have looked very, very different.
And this is because there are no, what, semi-automatic weapons in Australia since that ban?
That's exactly right. I mean, there's a saying amongst many very senior law enforcement officials here in Australia that even the crooks have bad guns in this country. Those who are looking to get semi-automatic weapons through the illegal economy, you know, they quickly bubble up and to the attention of law enforcement and intelligence officials. I don't think, unfortunately, the same case can be made for New Zealand.
So your message to the gun lobby, which and those wishing to preserve the laws in New Zealand, is that this changing the laws to the way they are in Australia would make a difference?
I think this is very, very clear that they would and have made a difference in Australia. I mean, many nations and Western liberal democracies now look towards Australia and what we've done in terms of gun ownership. And this is not to say that it's anti-gun. What has happened is assault weapons and semi-automatic weapons have been removed from private citizens who don't have a reason to hold them. Unfortunately, that has seen the demise of certain types of sporting activities and competitions. But, however, the community is safer, and we no longer in this country, in Australia, have serial or spree killings involving weapons.
Should the security services, well, in New Zealand, but also potentially in Australia, given the suspect was Australian, should he have been picked up by the security services, the intelligence services?
Look, I want to sit there and assure you and those people who are watching this program, having worked with your agencies, both law enforcement and intelligence agencies, and been part for almost a quarter of a century of the Australian agencies in this case, I want to say that on both sides of the ditch, I can guarantee you that law enforcement officials and intelligence officials worked hard, and they do so all the time, to prevent these types of attacks. That there'll be a large number of those officials who'll be poring over the details as they become available on this specific case of Tarrant, wishing that they had have disrupted his attack. The question of not of whether they could have, well, look, you know, it is an incredibly difficult environment that our intelligence and security agencies work in. They receive a great volume of reporting, and it's increasing all the time. And it's very difficult online to identify the difference between, a young person who is sprouting absolute rubbish online versus someone who is bought into such a horrible vilifying dogma as Tarrant has. So, I mean, it was a very difficult task, and I'd hate to be able to sit there and say, yes, it could have been prevented by better intelligence. What I'd say is that, our agencies, be they policing or be they national security, can always do more with more money and can always do more with more laws. But what we have to do is ask ourselves, have we struck the right balance between freedom of speech and security? And on this occasion, it would have been better to see that this sort of attack not occur.
In your experience as a security expert, are you seeing a rise of extreme right activity online?
I think that we've seen it online. I think it's the question is I guess over the last 30 years in Australia, well, in fact, throughout our history, almost since the time of the first arrival here in Australia, we've seen various nationalists and white supremacist groups come and go. In the 80s, we saw a gentleman called Jack Van Toren, who was involved in firebombing five Chinese restaurants in Australia, hit him serving time. In the 1990s, we saw the rise of a right-wing militia group called the Aussie Freedom Scouts. We've seen numerous other groups arise and fall, but they tend to have a very small membership. The problem of today is that these small, hardcore number of right-wing extremists now have the benefits of social media that we all have and are able to hook up globally into a global network, and they're able to create their own echo chambers where they spread their own poisonous message to each other and the whole time egging each other on. So unfortunately, I think that there is a real potential for the problem that has been around for a long time, white supremacy and right-wing extremism, to continue to become an issue for security agencies.